Okay, so law curves are going to require a little bit of background information, so I'm going to talk about them a little bit before we actually do them. This is an example of a part that was modeled using law curves, so you can use mathematical expressions to drive your geometry. All right, so curves, law curves, are curves just like the other curves that we've used before, in that they can exist in three dimensions. The really nice thing about law curves is that you define them mathematically. All right, so for instance, if we have this expression y equals mx plus b, if we start to know some parameters, like maybe we know what m is and maybe we know what b is, and these could actually be variables that get calculated some other way, you know, in your expressions editor, but we can set up a curve that will model this relationship between x and y. And so, sort of to begin with this, we want to know how much of that equation we want to evaluate. So we're kind of setting up the domain of this function. So the way this is done is with this thing called the t parameter. So just understand that there's going to be an expression that you'll set up, and you'll name it t. Now, it doesn't actually have to be named t, but we're going to call it the t parameter because that is the default. And what you, the only thing you really need to know about t is that you're going to set t equal to 1, but as nx goes through and iterates and solves your law curve, it is going to take t and assign it every, in parentheses, value from 0 to 1. So t is going to go from 0 to 100% of your curve, and how much of how big that is comes later. All right, but all t is going to be is something that starts at 0 and goes to 1. So the best thing to do is just create an expression called t and give it a value of 1, and then you can stop thinking. Well, you can't stop thinking about it. You're going to use it inside of xt. Now, I will say, I am talking about this as if we are strictly solving these functions with respect to x. All right, so they're going to be some function f of x or a function of y, your y value as a function of x. So it's actually much more powerful than that. If you'd like to define your equation some other way, totally fine. It's very flexible. But I'm just going to lock things down and say we're talking about with respect to the x-axis. Okay, so what that means is we're going to set up our domain. That is, how much of the x-axis do we want to actually evaluate y values for and z values? But that's going to be on the xt. Okay, so xt is going to be, it's going to tell you how much of the x-axis you want to set up. And what you'll do is you'll actually create an expression in your expressions editor called xt. And what you're going to do is set it equal to t times how wide you want this domain to be and how far shifted to the left you want it to be. Okay, so here if we're doing y equals mx plus b, and I don't know what the values are here, but we'll look at y in just a minute. But here we're solving it from negative 5 to positive 10. Okay, so that has a span of 15, and it's shifted from the origin left, that is negative 5 units. Okay, so our xt expression, so far we have two expressions. We have t, which is named 1, and we have xt, which has this expression in it, okay? And that's if we want a 15-unit-wide domain shifted to the left 5 units. Sorry. Okay, so let's go through this and think about, you know, how this works. So we'll say as nx goes through, t is going to take every value from 0. So the first value is going to be 0. 0 times 15 is 0. Subtract 5. And we see that our first value is going to be negative 5. And then it goes through all these other values. And finally, at its maximum, t is going to be equal to 1. So 1 times 15 is 15 minus 5 is 10. So our highest value, we will end at positive 10. All right, so this may seem a little bit convoluted, but trust me, in just a few minutes, this will become just crystal clear, especially if you remember that this number is the span, that's the width of the domain that you're going to get, and this number is the shift. So if you just always structure your xt value like this, then that will work out for you. All right, let's see. So now your yt, and I said that we're always going to set this up so that we're looking at f of x as some a series of y values. So here we've set our y is equal to 0.5x plus 5. So this follows that y equals mx plus b. This is our slope, and this is our positive, our y intercept. All right, so here's how this works. Here's our expression so far. T is equal to 1. Xt is equal to t times 15 minus 5, and our yt is 0.5xt plus 5. Now, instead of saying x, we're referring to xt. Okay, this is just a default variable name, and if we had multiple functions, we could have xt1, xt2. We could name them whatever you want to. Okay, they could be anything. They could be Penelope, if you wanted to. I actually had some guy that named his expressions things like Gerbil and Phyllis, but don't do that. All right, so XT1, XT2 makes a little bit more sense. And so what you see here is that it's going to solve YT in terms of XT, and that's solving the Y as a function of X. Only it's the YT as a function of XT. And you see that it starts at negative 5, because of how we structured our xt. Okay, so it's not going to solve every value of y equals mx plus b. It has a definite starting point and a definite ending point. All right, now zt, in our case, is going to be equal to 0. But do know that it's powerful enough that you could set this equal to the sine of t or the sine of x or something, the sine of xt, and get motion or deviation in the z-axis. You could have a z. These work perfectly well in three dimensions. But for this class, just set zt equal to 0, and then your function will lie in a nice plane. And you will have a very nice graphing calculator inside of NX. All right, so let's do an example. One example might be to design an antenna or a solar collector, something like that. In fact, this works really well as a solar trough. So we have a parabola here, and we have something here at the focus so that we can actually install something like a collector here. And when the light rays come in here all parallel from the sun, and this thing is pointed at the sun, those rays will bounce off, and they will all collect here. So this is our series of formulas that we want. Okay, notice that they're just given in terms of, well, it's kind of messy. Y equals this, X equals that, T, Z equals that. So we'll have to clean these up a little bit. So what we'll do is we'll start in X. And really, these could be in any units. You do have, there is one of the assigned parts that does ask for something about the volume in cubic centimeters. So that one will definitely need to be in metric. But in this case, we're just looking at these as units. Okay, so we're going to go with that. All right, so starting off, we'll go to Tools, Expressions, and we will need to set up, this is for that parabola. We'll set up T first of all, and let's see, number, dimension, I'm going to go with unitless for these. I've just found that it works best if you just go unitless. That way he's not worried too much about keeping track of the units. And the formula for this is just 1. And NX will do all the heavy work of converting, of starting whatever our T parameter is. He's going to start at 0 and end at 1. All right, now our XT from our assignment is going to tell us T times 5 minus 1. Now what that tells us is that it's nicely symmetrical about the origin, that's going to go in both directions 5 units. This is our span, it's going to be 10 units all the way across, it's going to be shifted over to the left 5 units. So what we need to do is make that our XT. So XT is going to be, well, let's start with unitless. It's going to be equal to T, which we already have defined, times 10 minus 5. Don't need any kind of parentheses or anything in there. All right, and we'll apply that, and we'll create now our YT. Since we have XT, you want to define these in order, because you see XT refers to T, and YT is going to refer to XT. So those need to be in order. Change our dimensionality to unitless. Our YT is equal to XT squared, caret 2, divided by 4, well, 4 times P, and I forgot to put our focus in there. So let me just stop there, and I'll save that much. That's not finished. And I need to make my P parameter. I forgot that it referred to P. So P is the focus of my my parabola. And, oh, it's probably okay to put the units of length in there, because it is actually a unit of length, but I think it's fine to go unitless with that. And now I'll repair this. So this is 4 times P. All right. And I do want the parentheses in there so that I don't wind up dividing by 4 and then multiplying the thing I divided by 4 times P. So I'm going to put those in there. Update that. Okay, and I need my ZT in here. That's too many Z's. ZT, and ZT is going to be equal to 0. So if I put something other than 0 in there, unitless, if I put something other than 0 in there, it would actually put my curve off of the Z0 axis. It would float in space somewhere. But anyway, that's no big deal. All right, so with those done, we'll say apply, okay. And we're ready to put in the curve. So menu, insert, curve, law curve. And notice, there it is, okay? Our work is already done because we took the defaults. Now, if we had a different curve, if we wanted to have two curves in here, we could do that. We would just name one XT1 and use XT1, YT1. Or maybe if they both had the same domain, I could just have one XT would do both of them, and I could have YT1 and YT2 if I had two functions that shared the same domain. And you will. So you want to be able to create two separate Y laws, YT1, YT2, if you have two functions in the same model. But that'll all work just fine. So you see, this is how we could make something like a parabolic solar trough. In fact, we can come in here and do a sketch that will position the actual collector. We could have a collector of some diameter. We'll just go with a diameter 0.5 maybe. And we could make it P. Double click on this. We could make that P units off of the origin. So where is that parameter P? Maybe not a great name for a function. I just want it to be P. Let's take P. There we go. Okay, so he sees P. Had to just click away there. All right, so that's going to be at our focus. All right, so we could take that then, and we can use that law curve. We can use that sketch, and we can extrude those. Now, if we're extruding just a curve by itself, I'll just show you this because we hadn't talked about this. But we can actually take and convert that that sheet. You see, this is a two-dimensional surface. We can actually go in and insert, where would it be, like offset scale, and thicken. So we can thicken that out. Now we want to make sure that we go to the outside, because the math is important on the inside. The outside, we can grow away from that, whatever the thickness of our material winds up being. So we'll make it out of quarter plate. There we go. All right. And the reason you see it hashed like that is because you actually have two things happening at the same on the same face there. But anyway, there's your solar collector, and you can go in and design. You know, you can use your top-down assembly techniques to design a some kind of a structure to hold this and make sure that this is in the right position. But there you go, all created with law curves. Okay, so the first part of your assignment is to create a this plumb bob where this curve is defined by this equation. Okay, so notice that our xt is going to start here at 0, and our xt is going to end at 6. Okay, so you'll need to set up your xt such that the span is 6 and the shift is none. All right, so that's your xt. Your yt is here. Now, you'll need to plug this into the expressions editor in a way that it will understand what you're saying. X divided by 12, and then multiply that by the square root of this stuff inside here. Of course, this will become xt, and that will become xt. Your zt will be 0, and your yt, well, this is your yt, all right? And, of course, your t is going to be equal to 1. So the only thing new about this is that it's going to ask you to, you know, you'll take that, and then you'll do a revolve around it. So you'll do a revolve of that curve. But anyway, it asks you to find the how much will it weigh if it has this density, 8.5 grams per cubic centimeter. And I can't remember if I showed you how to get this or not yet at this point in the class. But you can do this pretty easily to get the volume. You can go to analysis measure and make sure you're looking at solids. Oh, I'm stuck on vector here. So we're looking for an object, and we're looking for a solid body. And if I just click this, and if I have this on, it's going to give me volume measurements. All right, so if that enabled, I can just click that that volume. Of course, you're going to do this with your plumb bob, not with this, but this is just an example of how to get that. And there's your volume. Now, this is in cubic inches, and so you'll need to start your other model in millimeters, and you'll probably get cubic millimeters here. So you'll need to know how to convert cubic millimeters to cubic centimeters. But I don't think that will give you any trouble. Don't just jump down here to the weight, because you don't know what density he's using here. I think he's probably defaulting to steel or something like that. So that's how you would get that volume. All right, now this one has a snake on it. Okay, so this is your nozzle assignment. Don't let that snake bother you too much. Most of what it's saying is start at 1. Well, from negative 2 to 1, so we'll need to start at negative 2, and that's given up here. Okay, so we're looking for two functions. We got one that forms the outside of this part, which is just this nice linear function here. It looks like y equals mx plus b with some negative m. And then there is this little parabola on the inside. Okay, now you don't have to derive these or anything. They are given to you. This is the outer radius. It has a function of negative x plus 3, so our m is negative 1. So negative x plus 3. Of course, this will have to be something like your yt1 will be this. Your yt2 will be the inner radius. Now, it says that both of these happen to both equal the same thing at negative 2 and positive 1. So they meet. They intersect at negative 2, and they intersect again at positive 1. So what we'll need to do is just use the same xt, and it will have a span of 3 and a shift of negative 2. So that's that will tell you how to lay out your xt. T, of course, as always, is just going to be equal to 1. And then these snakes on here, oh my goodness. So what I'm asking you is to verify that the volume of this shape is equal to this definite integral. Okay, so that's what this means. So we go in and find the volume of this, and if you're to evaluate this, it should be equal to 117 pi over 5. This came out of my old calculus book from many years ago. But this is what it should evaluate to. You don't even have to do the integral. That has been done for you. And all you have to do is verify that this volume equals this amount. And we'll just see if that's right or not. All right, so that's those are your two assignments. And I'm not going to do those for you. I've shown you how to do it. But again, it's not the kind of thing where if you just say click here, click there, you're going to get it. You have to actually go through and learn how to do this. Okay, but definitely let me know if you have any questions or problems with the assignment.